You and I have to fight for what we don't feel. For me, the reason I'm on this earth is very simple. I want to give people hope. But that doesn't mean I always feel hope. Some people think I don't drink coffee because I'm just Tigger on steroids. But the truth is, it's not always unicorns shooting rainbows out of their nostrils, prancing around to robustly flavored donuts of fun, falling like jelly beans and Skittles from the rainbow. Sometimes life is very difficult. And for me, what God has taught me over the years is that hope is a journey and joy is a choice. And we have to fight for what we don't feel. You say, Ben, I got problems. Welcome to humanity. In the world, you will have tribulation, Jesus said, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Joy is a choice. Hope is a journey. And we have to fight for what we don't feel. I realize you might not feel hope. Are you going to lay down? Are you going to rise like a phoenix from the ashes? I know you might be predisposed toward depression. Like me, I get caught in my head. Are we going to stay down? Or are we going to fall seven times and rise up seven times? Because that's what the righteous man does. I know there are times when we get lost in the vortex and we stare into the abyss and said abyss stares back into us. Are we going to stay there? Or after we carry our cross daily, are we going to have a daily resurrection? Are we just going to stop with, I died in Christ? Or are we going to say, now Christ lives through me and I've resurrected as a new person? Are we going to be nihilists and all we do is predict our own death? Or are we going to be like Jesus, who every time he predicted his crucifixion, he also predicted his resurrection? We are hope dealers. That is who we are. You are a temple. I am light. We are salt. We are going to give hope to the world. We're going to give Christmas cheer 365 days a year. And we're going to fight for what we don't feel. I know Christmas time has higher suicide rates. I'm aware that for some of you, Christmas time is a reminder of the loved ones who are no longer with you, or the family struggles, or the financial issues. But that does not mean we are not going to fight for what we don't feel. The Apostle James said, count it all joy when you fall into various trials and tribulations. Joy is a choice. You count it joy by an act of your own volition. Peter said, do not be surprised by the fiery tribulation which perfects your faith, because like fire to gold perfects the image of the smelter, and then he knows the gold is purified and unadulterated and unalloyed when he can see his own image reflected in the pot of melted gold. So too, the image of God is perfected in us when we go through fiery tribulations, because the fiery tribulations do not burn us, they forge us, because God himself defines himself as, in Hebrews, a consuming fire who never burns what we are, he only burns what we are not. So we're the people who've gone through hell carrying buckets of water for those still consumed by the fire. We are going to go through hell, but we're not going to smell like smoke. So if you're going through hell, keep going and fight for what you don't feel. Come on. That's what we do. That's who we are. We are warriors. We are soldiers. Paul the Apostle said, endure hardship as good soldiers of Jesus Christ. I'm not going to let you lie down. I'm not going to tell you, oh, just sit down and bear suffering. The Bible says tribulation produces patience. The word patience in Romans 5 is hupomone. It doesn't mean you sit down and bear things. It means you rise up, stand up, conquer things, and convert their very nature so that situations that were painful, you convert into pain fuel, and it drives you on to your destiny. We fight. That's who we are. We're warriors of hope. The world needs happy warriors. That phrase just gives me chills. Happy warriors. Joy is a battle, and it's one we fight gladly. C.S. Lewis called it the gaiety of battle. That means the joy of warfare. Young men, there's something exhilarating about stepping onto the battlefield. And I'm a young man, so I'm in battle mode. That's what we do. We fight for hope. Oh, but Ben, I don't feel hope. Okay, so you're gonna mope? Or are you gonna say, I'm not an Eeyore? That's not who I am. I'm not going to walk around saying nobody likes me, everyone hates me, why don't I just go eat worms? I'm going to stand firm on the promise that he gives me a joy that no man can take from me, and I'm going to enjoy where I'm at on the way to where I'm going. I didn't even preach that first service. That was just right now. So fight for what you don't feel. Here's the thing. You know what drives me insane? That everyone thinks Jesus wept is the shortest verse in the Bible, because brevity is the wit of genius, and people think, well, that must be the most pithy saying in the Bible, Jesus wept. Failing to realize that right after he raised a guy from the dead. Like, you don't pause the movie in the middle of the story when all the suffering is happening and the conflict of the plot. You got to go to the happily ever after. Furthermore, Jesus wept isn't the shortest verse in the Bible. In English it is, but remember, the Bible wasn't written in English. It was written in Hebrew, in Greek. Greek, the New Testament, was written, was the language it was written in. In the original language, Jesus wept is 16 characters. But in 1 Thessalonians 5, Paul said, rejoice always, and that is 14 characters. So actually, in the original language, the shortest verse in the Bible is rejoice always. If brevity is the wit of genius, our mantra is not, I wept, it's, I rejoice always. Come on, somebody. And you don't stop at the grave, you get to the resurrection. In Acts, the cross was half of their focus. The other half was the resurrection. You can't stop at the cross. You got to go to the resurrection. You can't stop with Jesus wept. You got to go to rejoice evermore because Lazarus raised from the dead. I didn't say that first service either. Okay, here's something I did say first service. Cognitive restructuring. We're talking about being happy warriors, fighting for what we don't feel. Navy SEALs, they practice a psychological trick called cognitive restructuring. Would everyone say cognitive?
Cognitive.
Restructuring. Now, I'm a big fan of SEALs. I've studied them over the years. And what cognitive restructuring is if you're going through really bad times, you train your brain by saying things you don't feel to trick your cerebral gray matter into believing it's true. So what Navy SEALs will do is if they're getting shot, if they're getting hypothermia in the Coronado Bay in San Diego where they train, they're going through Hell Week undergoing 96 hours of sleep deprivation, what they'll do is they repeat these two words. Good times. Good times. I've actually been practicing this. Good times. He broke my heart. Good times. I don't have enough money for gifts. Good times. My car broke down. Good times. Last night I got a ticket. This is true. Good times. Good times. And you start saying this, and here's what's interesting. Navy SEALs, when they get shot, they'll say, good times. They get shot, they're like, how you doing, brother? And the guy who's shot's like, I'm solid, good times. And when you say this, it's amazing what happens. There's power of life in the tongue, and you start convincing yourself that it really is good times. This is what Joel said, let the weak say I am strong. So often, if we don't see it, we don't say it because we walk by sight, when really the Bible tells us we should walk by faith. And I won't say what I don't see. So Joel says, it doesn't matter if you feel weak, let the weak say I am strong. Next time you're especially weak, stand up, throw your shoulders back, and say, I am strong. That's what Joel says to do. Let the weak say I am strong and rejoice evermore as a happy warrior. That's why I'm so thankful that we get to open up this service with communion, because what Jesus does at the table of communion is he shows us that he can be touched by our weaknesses. He would take everyday matter. There's powerful symbiotic resonance in this. I was just studying this last night. But when Jesus took bread and wine, and he said, take, eat, this is my body, drink, this is my blood, he was taking everyday materials that you and I use on a habitual, congenital basis, and he calls it sacred. Which is really interesting because at that time, the disciples thought the temple was sacred. They're like, look at these massive stones. They were called the Herodian stones. Herod was one of the richest people, some historians say, to ever live. So he built this elaborate temple. And they said, wow, look at the stones. And Jesus said, not one of these stones is going to be left upon the other. This divide, this dual awareness between the secular and the sacred needs to be torn down. And what I'm trying to tell you is you are the temple for the Holy Spirit. Everything is suddenly sacred. Even bread and the cup, just an everyday meal, you're like, whoa, this is the body and blood. He was taking everyday material to do this. Solomon, have you ever heard the phrase, you need the wisdom of Solomon to riddle out this mathematical problem? Solomon, the wisest man to live in the Old Testament, was way ahead of his era, epoch, and age, way beyond his years accounted for. When he dedicated the temple to the Lord, he said, Lord, we know that you cannot dwell in a temple made of hands. He understood that it was symbolic, but really he said, the whole earth, as we just sang, is filled with the glory of God. A mere building cannot contain you. And what I want to encourage you to do is know that when you came to church today, it's not like, okay, you're doing the sacred now, but when you get in your car and listen to Harry Connick Jr. Christmas music and drink eggnog, suddenly that's secular. You are a temple. The whole earth is filled with the glory of God. Everywhere you go, you're carrying the Lord with you, and his joy is your strength when you've touched him with your weakness, not just in church, because you're not the light of the Christians, you are the light of the world. And out there, he will strengthen you to be joyful. Amen. Not just when you come to church. Joy is out there too. And that's why I love Jesus's prayer that he taught us to pray. We prayed it earlier in the service. Why did we do that? Well, I just studied this morning, but did you know that when you repeat prayers, this is why Catholics do Hail Marys and the Rosemary. When you repeat prayers, Rose, sorry, I got that confused. Hail Marys. Rosemarys, yeah. I'm not a Catholic, so I might get that a little confused. Be that as it may, I was listening to a Catholic priest talk about this morning on YouTube, and what he was saying is, this is interesting, that when you repeat prayers, neurologically, I love studying the brain, it turns off the left lobe of your brain, which is the part of your brain where you worry. And when you repeat prayers, what happens is you turn off the worry part of your brain. And there's something powerful about just saying throughout the day, "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." And you're submitting to him, you're trusting in him, you're believing in him, not just in church, but out in the world as a happy warrior, turning off the left lobe of your brain that becomes a worry word. Are you tracking with me? So we're gonna go to John 9 verse 1, and we are gonna go fast, so you better buckle up. John 9, 1 today, we have a lot to cover. Now, if you're there, would you please say, "Fight for what you don't feel." Okay, that was nice. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. Everyone say blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" They were very compassionate creatures. That was sarcasm in sardonic tones, if you didn't catch that. Verse 3. Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him." Everyone say, "The works of God revealed in him." Verse 4, "I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Verse 6, when he had said these things, he spat on the ground and made clay with the saliva, and anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And he said to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which is translated sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. Skip down to verse 14. Now it was a Sabbath, everyone say Sabbath, when Jesus made the clay, everyone say made the clay, and opened his eyes. Uh-oh, what is John telling us? Jesus was breaking the law of his day. You were not allowed to make clay on the Sabbath. That was considered work. We're gonna go into that in just a moment, my friends. Verse 1 tells us Jesus was passing by. He sees a man born blind. He's just passing by, and a miracle happens as he passes by. Some of the greatest miracles we pass by because we don't have eyes to see. The ancient rabbinic tradition says that when Moses came across the burning bush, we're told, according to the rabbis, that the bush didn't start burning when he came upon it. It was burning all along when he happened upon it, and he just so happened to have eyes to see it. How many other people passed by, the rabbis wondered? This same burning bush, but Moses was attentive enough to see it. How many of us miss miracles throughout the day because we're doing this? And there's miracles to be had all around us as we're passing by. The wonder, as we wander among the wonders happening all around us. Look at verse 2. The disciples say, "Okay, Jesus, why was this guy born blind? Was it because he sinned or because his parents sinned?" First of all, how is it possible that he was born blind because of his sin? Because he was born blind. There are two people in the New Testament who were born with a malady. How could he have sinned his way into blindness? It says he was born that way. Well, two reasons. Number one, some of the Jewish rabbis believed in prenatal sin. Would everyone say prenatal sin? And this was the belief that you could sin in your mother's womb. Case in point, Genesis. Esau and Jacob were fighting in the womb, arguing in the womb, quarreling in the womb to see who could get out first to get the birthright. And Jacob the heel snatcher snatched Esau's heel and tried to get out first. So they said, you can even war and fight and sin in your mother's womb. But secondly, some of the Jewish rabbis had read Plato, and they believed in the pre-existence of the soul. Plato was a Greek philosopher about 300-400 years before this was this story took place. And Plato believed that the soul exists in a heavenly chamber and then enters into a body that is fitting for it when the time is ripe. So they believed you could actually sin in a previous life. They believed in the pre-existence of the soul, which was a Platonic idea. But I love what Jesus says. He says, neither this man nor his parents sinned that he was born blind. Jesus cuts right to the issue. Suffering is not always the result of sin. There are storms of correction, don't get me wrong, but more often there are storms of protection. And some of the storms in your life did not come to disturb your existence. Some of the storms that you're going through did not come to disturb your life. They came to clear your path. And not all storms are those of correction. Some are storms of protection. And Jesus says, it's not his fault. Can I tell you? If you're suffering today, perhaps these words ring true for you. It's not your fault. You can be in the wrong place for doing the right thing. Jesus actually said, blessed are you if you're persecuted, suffering, for righteousness' sake, for doing the right thing. Sometimes you'll be in the wrong place for doing the right thing. Paul and Silas healed a girl who had portentous, oracular, fortune-telling abilities. Her bosses were so upset that he had lost his upward mobility income by using her dark gift. They then play on the anti-Semitism of the crowd, say these Jews are going against Roman customs. They get thrown into a prison in Philippi. Philippi, known for its geographical earthquakes, one of these notorious earthquakes happened, and Paul and Silas were set free. But before the prison doors were opened, what were Paul and Silas doing? They were singing hymns. When your night is at your darkest, that's when your praise has to be at its loudest. When you feel the weakest, that's when Joel said, let the weak say that I am strong. In the same way, listen to this, you might be in the wrong place for doing the right thing, but just because you can't see it doesn't mean you're not gonna say it. And that's what this man had to understand. It wasn't his fault. I got back at 2:30 a.m. last night from speaking in New York City, and I was on a subway in New York, and I saw this homeless man go into a soliloquy, a deep speech about his misfortune and all the things that he had gone through. I felt this evil impulse in me that said, if he had made better decisions, he wouldn't be there. If he had made different choices, he wouldn't be there. Maybe it's his fault. Lord, why is he this way? He was talking to himself, seemed crazy. Why is he this way? What do you do wrong? I think the Lord would say, really? Really? You're gonna walk by somebody who's hurting and you're gonna analyze and puff your pipe as you pontificate like a professor at Princeton. And you're like, was it prenatal sin, the Platonic pre-existence of the soul? Jesus is like, really? And it hit me in that moment. I don't know why he's here. Maybe some of it was his fault. Maybe some of it wasn't. Maybe he had a different socioeconomic environment than I did. Maybe he wasn't raised with the kind of parents that I was raised with. Maybe he suffered misfortunes in health that I've never, I don't know his story. My job is not to judge, my job is to love. And I know that this might not ring psychic cherries with some people if you're thinking I'm talking politics. I'm not talking government here. I'm talking Bible. The book of Proverbs says, if we close our ears to the cries of the poor, the Lord will close his ears to us. Not talking about what the government should do, I'm talking about you and me. And ultimately, are we the kind of people who say, it's his fault, that's why he's suffering? Or do we say, maybe I should be like Jesus and actually help the guy? Come on, we're hitting close to the bone here. Because sometimes what we do is we sit down and it's easy to throw stones when you're not in the tent. Oh man, that stinks. I wonder what he did wrong. I don't know what it's like to live homeless on the streets of New York City. It's freezing there right now. Like New York's way colder than I thought it'd be. I don't know what that's like, but you know what I can do? I can help him. Maybe if we spent a little more time helping and a little less time analyzing, the world might be a different place. I'm not saying he didn't make bad decisions. I'm not saying he made good decisions. I'm not saying the other way around. I'm just saying Jesus is telling us in this text, sometimes suffering is not the result of sin. And so what Jesus does is he helps the guy while his disciples are blogging. Jesus is helping. Enough said. Let's keep going. By the way, did you know you can hijack your brain into happiness? Research shows that compassion boosts your immune system, affects your heart rate and blood pressure, and activates the executive frontal lobe of your brain. So when you show compassion to others, it hijacks your brain into happiness. And sometimes I get so lost in the labyrinthine maze and vortex of my own thought life that I forget to get out of my head and look at other people who are hurting and show compassion on them. And when you show compassion on people, research shows this is one of the secrets to hijacking your brain into happiness. Pretty cool. Look at verse 3. He says, this man was not born blind because he or his parents sinned, but that the works of God might be revealed in him. Wow. His pain is a platform for the Prince of Peace's power to be palatable and palpable and potent for all to see. Paul said it this way, Lord, take this messenger from Satan away from me. Thrice I prayed, remove this thorn from the flesh. But Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you, and my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Paul said, therefore will I rejoice in persecutions, necessities, distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. Let the weak say, I am strong, echoing the words of Joel hundreds of years earlier. And the interesting thing about this is Jesus says this guy's pain and malady and misfortune is going to be the platform upon which I display God's power. For me, my Achilles heel has been depression. I've been very open about that. I've struggled with depression for many, many years, and God consistently heals my heart. But why is my greatest strength hope? Like, why do I know my mission so clearly? Like, I'm laser focused with what I do. I'm going to give people hope. I know why I'm here. I'm gonna give people hope. I'm gonna give the world hope before I die. That's why I'm here. But why do I know that? Because my greatest weakness has been depression. And now my greatest strength is in that very area, hope. Alfred Adler was a psychologist. And you guys know that I have some bones to pick with psychiatry. I'm not saying all psychiatrists are bad, because I get people mad at me for this. There are good psychiatrists out there. Viktor Frankl is one of them. But here's what I'm saying. Psychiatry is built upon a foundation that is conjecture and theory. That theory being, you have something called, drumroll please, a subconscious. Years ago, I was reading Jean-Paul Sartre's Existentialism, and he said, me and the existentialists do not believe that the subconscious exists. I'm like, wait. I read it over and over again. I'm like, wait. Is the subconscious even real? I did some studying. Let's do some brain scans. Okay, you have your hippocampus. That's the seat of memory. Okay? You have the part of your brain that's called the amygdala. That's what they call the lizard or rat brain, the part of fear and anger and stress, and high blood pressure is located from that part of your brain. You also have the cerebrum. Athletes use that. Hand-eye coordination and the prefrontal cortex, creative thinking, focus, concentration, the anterior cingulate cortex, the place of localized empathy and compassion and fellow feeling for your fellow featherless bipeds. But the subconscious is nowhere there. So when people walk around saying, I have this personality, personality is not in your brain. That was made up by psychiatrists. I know this is crazy. Personality is not in the Bible. It was made up by psychiatry. Daddy issues. The Oedipus complex. When we talk about power struggles or inferiority complex. These were made up by psychiatrists. And I'm not saying that certain diseases mentally are not real. I know firsthand that chronic dysthymia is a real malady. I'm aware of that. But I also would push the envelope and say I'm not totally positive that all the labels that psychiatry has constructed that we wear are necessarily always true. I could walk around saying, oh, I'm so OCD, give me my hand sanitizer, because I tend to be obsessive compulsive. I couldn't find my hand sanitizer just now. But I couldn't. And I'm like, oh shoot. And I was in the middle of studying and I didn't want to go down and get it. So I'm like, you know what? It's okay. It's okay. But if psychiatry, if it tells me, oh, you have OCD, And I'd say, actually, no, I have CDO. It's like OCD, but the letters are in alphabetical order like they're supposed to be. Give me my hand sanitizer. It's like, no. Maybe, and I could be wrong, maybe Jesus is capable of healing some people. If he can heal a guy blind from birth, I don't know, maybe he can heal me of imaginary subconscious issues. Listen, I talked about this in Seattle. I talked about SAD, okay? Seasonal affective disorder. And somebody came up to me afterwards, like, my wife works with SAD, and I'm like, okay, just tell me where in the brain that is. Seasonal affective disorder, SAD. I'm not trying to offend people. But like, what psychologists now tell us is that consciousness is shaped by labels. The ancient Greeks didn't have a word for blue, so believe it or not, they could not see blue. Let me give you another example. There's certain Polynesian tribes that don't have a word for grief, so when someone dies, they say they experience fatigue. They can't experience grief like we can. They experience fatigue. If you want more on this, read C.S. Lewis, The Problem of Pain, but he talks about the difference between sentience and consciousness, and the reason animal suffering is different than human suffering, he argues, and I'm actually a vegetarian, but he argues that animal suffering, they're not aware of the suffering that they're going through in the same way that we are. He said the real pain is not a toothache. The real pain is staying awake at night thinking about your toothache. And so if we walk around with labels, I'm OCD, I'm CDO, I'm chronic dysthymia, chronic hypothymia, chronic cyclothymia, I'm ADD, I'm ADHD, I'm CDO, I'm OCD, inferiority complex, daddy issues, Oedipus complex, my subconscious is an orc dungeon where goblins make swords, as Sigmund Freud would make me believe, it's a strange place where dark things swim, and maybe Jesus is like, be healed, and I'm like, oh, sick. Like, that's pretty dope. And I do want to say this. If you are here and you work with these illnesses, I need to just tell you the truth. A lot of these illnesses were not invented by doctors. They were invented by pharmaceutical companies who go to their marketing. This is true. They go to their marketing department and they say, invent a disease so we can sell people a cure. And if suddenly we're in the brave new world popping soma and everyone feels depressed, then suddenly we're in 1984. And George Orwell's vision comes true. Now, let me say, before anyone DMs me or emails me about this, I think if you're in psychology and psychiatry, you're doing good work. But please do your research. And please study the scriptures. And please do brain scans. I don't know if you're aware of this. So much of psychiatry and even the drug industry, I can't believe I'm talking about this. This was not for service. What psychiatrists are doing, they're throwing dots in the dark because they're giving you prescription medication without giving you a brain scan. Don't raise your hand, but I do wonder how many people here have been to a psychiatrist and you got a brain scan and then got a prescribed medication. Listen, I have friends who are on antidepressants and it's worked for them. I know there's a big debate about chemical imbalances. It's still a debate. We haven't come to a conclusion. Is it real or fictitious? You gotta remember, we know 2 to 8% of how the brain works. The brain is made up of the size of two fists, 86 to 100 billion interconnected neurons. We're still studying it, it's mysterious. So I don't have all the answers, nobody does today. But one of the things that's happening is we're not even brain scanning people and we're prescribing them medications, throwing darts in the dark, and that's why for some people it works and for some people it doesn't, because it's guesswork. And what I'm trying to say is, if you need to be on antidepressants, I can't believe I'm talking about this, and God's leading you to do that, and you have a doctor that you really believe is doing good work, awesome. I have friends that works for. On the other hand, I have friends who it doesn't work for and it only makes things worse. What I'm trying to say is that some of the diseases and labels that we put on ourselves, not all of them, do you hear me? Not all of them are fictitious, but many of them are labels that we live down to. And I think the Lord wants to heal us. I mean, sorry, if the people hate me for that. He's Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. Like, I'm sorry if he wants to heal you, but maybe Jesus would ask some people, do you want to be made well? That's what he said. Do you want it? Because victims get a lot more attention, so it's easy to stay in the dirt. I can't believe I went there. But so, to totally undo all of your applause just now, If you're a psychologist, psychiatrist, I believe you can do good work. I believe there are good people who are on antidepressants and it works for them. But I do not think that is the nepenthe, the panacea, the cure-all. I think we need to seek God. Say, maybe everything is not nice, neat, right angles. Maybe it's not always binary. Maybe these constructs are invented by psychiatry in some cases. So God, what do you want me to do? And then follow his wisdom. That was a big tangent, and that was important, I think. So here we go. Actually, it was important. Even if people don't like me, that's okay. Here we go. Alfred Adler. He was a psychologist who did good work. Again, I like psychologists. He discovered that at the turn of the 20th century, 70% of the art students that he studied had optical anomalies. And the greatest composers of history had ear degeneration, like Beethoven and Mozart. And what he found is your disadvantages are actually your strengths. Because when you have a disadvantage, that area of your life lies dormant. And so you have to awaken it and activate it by pouring constant attention and focus into it. And therefore, because you put so much attention into it, it becomes your strength. So he proved that, like, through ear degeneration, you get the best composers. Why are Mozart and Beethoven so good at composing? Partly because they had bad ears, so they had to pay extra special attention to what they heard. Why are art students so good when they have optical anomalies? 70% of the art students had eye problems because they have to focus extra hard on what the eye is seeing. And so too, he proved that many times our disadvantages force us to pour compensatory attitudes and focus into our weakness that was lying dormant, and then it transforms into our greatest strength, which is really just psychobabble for when I am weak, then am I strong. And what I want to tell you is this man, his weakness was his blindness, but Jesus said the works of God will be revealed in his blindness, not because he sinned or his parents sinned, but so that the work of God should be manifested in him. His weakness will be a platform for God's strength. Just you watch when I heal him. And I wonder how much he appreciated his eyes after that. Probably more than I do. Here's what's interesting. In the Bible, there are three left-handed people mentioned. You say, wow, that was out of left field. Watch this. Ties in really cool. Watch how the bow gets tied here. Three left-handed people are mentioned in the Bible. Back in that culture, to be left-handed was a curse. Today, it's advantageous for you. Like today, it helps, you know, athletes have an unorthodox approach, and left-handed pitchers can actually throw slower than right-handed pitchers and have a better shot at the major leagues because it throws batters off. But in biblical times, being left-handed was considered a curse. There are three left-handed people in the Bible. They all come from the same tribe, the tribe of Benjamin. The name Benjamin means son of my right hand. So all the Southies, all the Southpaws, all the left-handers come from the right-handed tribe. So all the left-handed people in the Bible come from the tribe of Benjamin, which means son of my right hand. And yet, their oddity was their commodity when they would own their oddness. Ehud is a case in point. I won't go into the story because a lot of you know it, but basically, when the Moabites were oppressing the Israelites for 18 years, Ehud, the southpaw, snuck into the presence of the king, DEFCON 1 vibes, Navy SEAL Team 6, paratrooper, recon, you know, he sneaks in, Chris Kyle Marks is a trail American sniper for the Hebrews. He like walks in, gets past TSA security with a dagger. How did he do that? Because back then, the Royal Palace Guard, I'm glad I'm making you laugh, the Royal Palace Guard would usually only frisk right-handed people. Left-handed people were cursed. They weren't even worth frisking. So he sneaks in with a dagger because he's a lefty. He could hide it better and therefore assassinated the king and then killed 10,000 lusty men of Moab. Why? Because his weakness was his strength. The curse did a reverse. His oddity was his commodity. And perhaps you should own your oddness. Because maybe what you're going through is not a result of something you did wrong. Maybe it's a result of something that God's gonna do right. Come on. Maybe what you're going through, maybe the blindness you're going through is because the Lord is going to manifest his works through that very illness, through that very sickness, through that very weakness. That's how he works. And that's what Jesus is saying in verse 3. Watch, actually the very area that he's weakest in, that's where God's power is gonna be made manifest. We are dropping some important veritable bars. Are you picking up what I'm throwing down, catching what I'm pitching, mowing what I'm growing? This is big stuff. Here we go. Verse four, and I gotta be quick. I literally said, guys, watch, I'm gonna end within an hour, and I didn't, but I'm gonna be quick. Verse four, Jesus says, I must finish the work that God has given me to do before night is coming. No man can work. I'm so glad Jesus finished the work that the Father had given him to do in verse 4. Just before Jesus went to the cross, he prayed the high priestly prayer. I have finished the work you've given me to do, John 17. And he went to the cross, and I'm so grateful that he didn't say, almost done, and then gave up the ghost. I'm so glad he said, it is finished. And by the way, the word it is finished is tetelestai, as you know in Greek. That's the same word Paul used in Philippians 1:6 when he said, God who began a good work in you will be faithful to finish it. The word finish in Philippians 1:6 is telestai. So as surely as Jesus carried his cross and said, it is finished, so too the Father will carry forth your purpose to completion, telestai, same Greek word. And Jesus says, there is a time coming when night will fall and no man can work anymore. And Jesus lived with this sense of urgency. The older I get, the more I'm aware that I don't have as much time on this planet as I think. I've said it before, but life is like a toilet paper roll. The closer you get to the end, the faster it goes. Can I get an amen? And Jesus is aware of this. He says, there is a time coming when the night falls, when death befalls us, when no man can work. And we need to live with this sense of urgency. So to Jesus, every day was important. Moses said, teach me to number my days that I might apply my heart to wisdom. If you want to make your days count, count your days. That's what verse 4 is showing us. Jesus is constantly aware, night's falling. I could pass this guy up and say, I'll get around to it later. But he said, nope, I've got to finish the work while day is still happening before the night of the cross falls. So too, greatness is something that doesn't happen in a day, it happens daily. And when you daily carry your cross to its resurrection, every day you're saying, this day matters. Friends, I know this might just seem like another December 2nd Sunday morning. This day matters. There's this philosophy in German metaphysics called eternal recurrence, and it's this belief that your life happens eternally and repeats itself endlessly. And I don't believe that's true, but I do think it's interesting to live your life that way. What if you had to repeat your life, your day, for the rest of your life? What if you had to repeat every day of your life eternally forever? Would it change the way you live today? And if so, maybe I should say, okay, Lord, night is falling, death is coming. What am I going to do with this day? It's a gift and I'm not going to waste it. I'm not going to squander it. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Night is coming when no man can work. Verse 4, I need to finish the work you've given me. But here's the thing. What you have to remember is Jesus is in his 30s at this point. Like, remember, he didn't do any mighty miracle for 30 years, didn't preach any great sermon that we have recorded for 30 years, didn't do any deed of daring in 30 years that we have in the annals. Like, for 30 years, Jesus was consistently practicing this daily walk with his Father so that when he entered into his sweet spot ministry, he was living with a sense of urgency. And in the same way, that's why Jesus, 90-some percent of his miracles were agricultural. Jesus was not an academic. He was living among the people in agricultural settings. In fact, that's the word paganism. It comes from agriculture because the cities were Christianized. And if you were in the city, you were a Christian. But if you were in the countryside, you were known as a pagan. That's why it's interesting that Jesus used agricultural metaphors. The word pagan comes from the word nature or agriculture. And Jesus spoke in the language they could understand. The common people heard him gladly, just as the 120 apostles and followers of Jesus on the day of Pentecost were at the upper room and they were speaking the language that everyone could understand in their various tongues on the day of Pentecost. So too, Paul said, we become all things to all men that we might win some. We got to speak the language of the people. We can say, oh, I'm blessed and highly favored, brother. We can go to Macy's and say, God bless you, sister. And they're like, no one even talks like that, dude. They just talk to me real. Like, why do I say sick and dope on stage? Because that's how I talk in real life. That's how people talk. I don't think we need to like walk around like, oh, I am blessed and highly favored. I am so holy. Father, I thank you that I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of everything I have to the poor and I do not wash my face so I can show how disfigured and holier than thou my face is. I'm not going to wash it. No, Neutrogena oils for me. I'm going to walk around holier than thou, praying in the marketplace, blowing my trumpets. I am giving to the poor today. I hope you all hear the ringing of the bells for this Christmas elf person asking for money on Christmas. I hope you all see I'm giving right now. Jesus is like, oh, no, knock it off. Like, honestly, I think what we need are people who are speaking the language of our generation. And that's what Jesus did so well. He wasn't quoting Socrates. He wasn't quoting Aristotle. He wasn't quoting Zeno. He wasn't quoting Epictetus or Epicurus or Plato. What was he doing? He was speaking in agricultural metaphors. Why? Because that's where he lived. He lived in a podunk town, so he spoke a podunk language. And here's what I think is interesting. That changed the world more than anyone has ever done. And Jesus spoke in these agricultural metaphors, but those metaphors still apply to us just as much as they did 2,000 years ago. And here's why. After the Industrial Revolution, Ford and Carnegie set up the educational system to make robots for the slaves for the Industrial Revolution, slaves for the Industrial Revolution, which is why we're having problems in our educational system today, but I won't go into that. But basically what, and I have friends who are teachers. I love school teachers, by the way. I think they need our honor and respect. But I do think there are problems also in the educational system. But I won't touch that right now. What I will say is after the Industrial Revolution, what happened is we live in an era of switches and buttons. Let me ask you, how many of you did not either flick a switch or press some kind of button today? Unless you're Amish, a Quaker, or a Shaker, we are always surrounded by switches. The problem with this is we live with a switch mentality. Jesus taught a seed mentality. He lived in the era of seeds. We live in the era of switches. So I say, Lord, I prayed. Why don't I have the fruit of the Spirit, which is love? He's like, it's the fruit of the Spirit. That requires a root. That requires sowing and reaping. Don't grow weary in well-doing, because if you sow, that's a seed, to the Spirit, you will reap life everlasting. But Lord, I prayed 5 minutes ago. To use a mixed metaphor, God's like, I'm not a hot pocket God, I'm a crock pot kind of God. Let my plans marinate. We live in the microwave generation. We all want to arrive, we just don't want to take the trip. I prayed, Lord, why aren't I more joyful? I prayed 5 minutes ago, why don't I have peace? I prayed 10 seconds ago, why don't I have more joy? It's like, it is fruit, not a switch. It takes time. Let me give you an example. If you want to grow in that area, you have to sow in that area. 106 times it says to wait for God. Watch this. This is sick. In order for a Chinese bamboo tree to grow, you must water it every day for 5 years. In those 5 years, there's no growth, not even a bud. If it is not watered for even one day, it will die. After 5 years of consistently watering it every single day with no growth, the Chinese bamboo will grow 80 feet in 42 days. Horticulture vibes. You can water a Chinese bamboo tree for 5 years and you will see no growth, not even a bud. But suddenly, you have to water it every day, daily. We die daily, Paul said. A seed must die and be buried in order for it to resurrect with new life. You might see no growth for 5 years. Lord, I'm sowing in that area. Why aren't I growing in that area? Suddenly, if you don't grow weary and well-doing, if you keep sowing to the Spirit, you reap everlasting life and 80 feet in 42 days. Game over. Jesus, what he did so well amongst everything, he has done all things well, is he lived with this sense of daily commitment to the Father's kingdom. And he said, today, the night is coming, verse 4, when no man can work, I must work today. Can I bear my heart with you? My work is very simple. Before I die, before my night comes, my one thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to give people, I'm going to give this generation, I'm going to give this world hope. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost ends of the earth. That's what Hope Generation is. Starts local, has concentric circles to global. What I want to do is I want to give people hope in Applegate, and I want to see that spread to impact our generation. For me, I'm unapologetic about what I'm here to do. Before I die, I will give people hope. With my dying breath, I will give people hope. I don't care how many people think I talk too fast. I don't care how many people think I'm annoying. I don't care how many people might misunderstand me. I know what I'm here to do, to give people hope. Dr. Seuss said that many of life's questions are complicated, but many of those answers are simple. The same guy who is such a genius that a publisher dared him to write a book using only 56 words and repeating them over and over again, and he came out with Green Eggs and Ham. He was onto something childlike there. The questions in life are existential angst, Camus, Hume, empiricism, nihilism, metaphysical, they're tough. But the answer is simple. For me, it's hope. He's the God of hope, and I'm gonna give people hope. That is the simple answer to the complex questions I've dived into. I tell you that to ask you, what are you here to do? I can't tell you. Paul said, I have not been disobedient to the heavenly vision. Hebrews says, the Lord will write his commandments and laws on the table of your heart. No man need teach his neighbor know the Lord. You will all know the Lord from the least to the greatest. What are you here to do? Every morning when you wake up, that is what should drive you. What has the Father called you to do? We live in the most distracted generation ever. If you are wondering why there are no more C.S. Lewis's, no more stories as good as Tolkien's, no music as moving as Pachelbel's, no cathedrals as great as the Gothic's, it's because maybe the architects of those buildings, the tellers of these stories, the writers of these books, and the composers of these symphonies are sitting on their couches playing iPhone games and Angry Birds. We are the most distracted generation ever. This does not dictate my day. This should not dictate your life. Oh, I have this text and that email and that DM and that comment. No, Father, what have you called me to do? I will finish the work you have given me to do because night is coming and I'm gonna live with a sense of urgency. I'm gonna be the best mother ever. I'm not talking about me, I'm using you as an analogy. I'm going to teach kids the Christian scriptures in Zimbabwe. I'm gonna work at Best Buy, and everybody that comes in, I'm going to encourage them with hope. I'm gonna be the guy who drives past the toll booth person. They have some of the highest suicide rates. Because all they get is, they have an average of 3.5 words spoken to them, and it's always angry. And I'm gonna be the person who gives that person joy. Do you get what I'm saying? Whatever we do, it must be fraught with intentionality. Knowing that night is coming, we must finish our work. We must finish our work. My heart for you is that at the end of your life, you would say, I fought for what I didn't feel. I fought the good fight. I have kept the faith. He's the author and finisher of my faith. And I have finished. I have finished. I have finished my course. We are not messing around. This is not a playground. This is a battleground. This is not a cruise ship. It is a battleship. We are here to go to war. What are you called to do? That's what the new covenant is. That's what the Spirit has put on your heart. You better do it before you die because it's going to look different than me. I might be the big toenail of the body of Christ, you're the hands. Others of you are the belly button. Some of you are the eyelashes. Others are the feet. We have to work together to say, Father, what have you called me to do? Like Paul said, I will not be disobedient to the heavenly vision. Old men will see visions. Young men will dream dreams, and we're going to change our generation. When we, each one of us individually, accomplish the calling that God has given to our life, then as amalgamation and conglomeration, confederation of congregations come together, and the most powerful army is a generation that never quits as we do what God has called us to do before the night falls. We are not messing around. This isn't hype. This is hope. I'm not a motivational speaker. I'm like, I want to preach like a dying man to dying people. Because we are. We're going to die. What are we going to do about it? It's not an accident. It's an appointment. And while we're alive, we better finish our work. Man, I'm preaching. Let's hurry. Verse 5. Give me 5 minutes and we will be done. This was way too long. It was supposed to be a 20-minute message. This is big. Verse 5. I just want us to live out the verse 4 thing. And I got to move on to verse 5. Verse 5, Jesus says, as long as I'm here, I'm the light of the world. Matthew 5:16, he said, you are the light of the world. That means the highest compliment we could ever get paid is the nickname that Jesus gave himself. Jesus calls you what he calls himself. It's not something to take lightly, the light of the world. Verse 6 says that he spits in the ground and makes clay and puts it on the guy's eyes. Why did he do that? Back then, they believed that spit had medicinal curative properties. If you don't think that's true, if you think it's merely superstition, just remember, what do you do when you burn your hand on a stove or get a paper cut? You put it in your spit. Now, if back then, they not only believed spit was medicine, but it also had supernatural healing powers. Tacitus The Roman historian writes about Vespasian, the emperor, actually healing an infirm guy with his spit. Now, if spit could magically heal people, I would heal the front row every time. Which this is not lost on me right here. I'm aware that you're in the no water zone, all of you guys. So perhaps what Jesus was doing is he was giving a stamp of approval to medicine. He's saying medicine is good as he spits in the ground using the medicine of his day. Now look at verse 7. It says that he makes clay with the spit and puts it in the guy's eyes. But verse 14 tells us he did this on a specific day. When did he make the clay? On the Sabbath. Why is that a big deal? Because that was illegal. Making clay was doing work, because what did the Israelites do for 400 years as slaves in Egypt? They made clay. So when Jesus made clay, he was freeing this man from his slavery. And he was saying, when I work, you rest, but when you rest, all work. And I'm making clay so you don't have to anymore. You are no longer a slave. I've come to free the captives. You're not living in Egypt anymore. You've been brought out of the world into the promised land. I make clay so you don't have to. He made clay on the Sabbath because that was work, thereby showing he was Lord of the Sabbath, because for 400 years, the Israelites made clay as slaves and saw no rest. So Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath, not the promised land, but the promised man, the rest that Hebrews talks about that we enter into as we're weary and heavy laden. When we work, God rests, but when we work, God rests. I was asked to throw out these nuggets because we're gonna throw out some deep nuggets really quick, and I'm still ending fast, watch. That little nugget of making clay is something that we often skim over. But can I encourage you, when you read the Bible, to look for connections, to look for parallels that the biblical authors are doing? John, if you read all of John 9, he continually references making clay. He specifically points out the Sabbath. Why? Because he's drawing these parallels for Jewish people to remember that they made clay for 400 years with no Sabbath. There's tons of these. Like when Jesus was born, he went to Egypt as a baby, and then he passed through water, the Jordan River, to wander in a wilderness for 40 days. Matthew wrote that. It was writing to a Jewish audience to remind people that Israel, as a baby nation, was taken to Egypt, passed through water, the Red Sea, to wander in a wilderness for 40 years. So Jesus was retelling Israel's story. Here's another one, Legion. The legions were the Roman military units that would walk through the streets of Israel and even murder people. There were 2,000 massacred by the Romans in Magdala. And the legions were these Roman military units that would murderously oppressed the Israelites, reminding everyone that they did not acknowledge Yahweh, yet they had beat the Jews. And the Jews, their greatest shame were these legions. That's why Jesus crosses the Sea of Tiberias, goes to the Gadarenes, which was an area the Romans had conquered, the Jewish people. And when he goes to the Gadarenes, he encounters a man who's demon-possessed. The legions were marching across the street, reminding the Israelites that they were shamed. What was the demon's name who possessed the man? He said, what is your name? What did the demon say? Legion, for we are many. Why did the author do that? Because what he was saying is the legions were Israel's greatest shame. So when Jesus cast the demon named Legion out of the man, he was ridding Israel of her shame, because that's what Jesus is here to do, to cast out our shame. There is no condemnation. He is the ultimate victor. Can I give you two more crazy ones? In the desert, Jesus is driven by the Spirit to wander among wild beasts. People skip over that. Why is that fascinating? Because Paul says that Jesus is the last Adam. The first Adam went into a garden to name the animals. Why? Because in Hebrew culture, naming animals, naming anything, meant you had ownership over it. To name something meant you possessed it. So when Adam was naming the animals, that was symbolic for he was having dominion over the earth and subduing it, just as God had called him to do. But Adam lost touch with animals, and now animals and man were fighting one another. But then Jesus comes onto the scene, and suddenly the lion and the wolf and the lamb and the sheep and the adder are all lying together in peace. A baby sticks his hand in an adder's den. It's not harming him. The young leads them, according to Isaiah. Jesus is wandering through a desert, and he's hanging out with and being ministered to by the animals. Why? Because the last Adam was having peace once more with the animals, just as the first Adam was supposed to do when he named them. And the word Eden means delight. It can also be translated desert. And Jesus went into the desert to hang out with the animals to turn it into an Edenic delight. Let me give you one more. Why was Jesus baptized at 30? Like, there's so many parallels if you'll study it this way. Like, why was he baptized at 30? In Hebrew culture, when you turned 30, you inherited everything your dad had. You came into your father's inheritance at 30 as a Jew in that culture. So when Jesus was baptized at 30, he inherited everything his father had. That's why he never did a miracle until he turned 30. Because he said, in my father's house are many mansions, but then he said, fear not, little flock, it's my father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. I am an heir of God, but you are a joint heir with Christ. It is my good pleasure to give the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And that's why he said that at 30. Anyway, this is where I close. This is my last nugget, and this is the big payoff, and then we're out of here. Guys, I probably won't do this again. I'm sorry, it's long. Here we go. It's probably because I went to bed at 2:30 and I was in New York yesterday. That's probably why. Here we go. And it's because I believe this stuff. Jesus did 3 miracles in Jerusalem. Everyone say 3. 3 in Jerusalem. One of them was his bodily resurrection. That's the story that we're told in the Gospels. One of his miracles happened in Jerusalem, raising himself. But 2 of those 3 miracles were done for specifically and directly to other people. He healed here the man at the pool of Siloam. The word Siloam means sent. Remember? Our text tells us that. Why was it called sent? Does anyone know? Because Hezekiah's tunnel was this aqueduct, this architectural, brilliant, progressive masterpiece that Hezekiah the king built so when there was a siege, water would come from outside the city and was sent into Jerusalem so that they wouldn't die of thirst, so that their parched state could be slaked when they drank water in the city. So the pool of Siloam meant sent because the waters were sent into Jerusalem. So he did that miracle in Jerusalem. But the 3rd miracle he did, bodily resurrection, John 9, our story here at the pool of Siloam, the 3rd and final one was when at the pool of Bethesda, the man was paralyzed for 38 years and Jesus asked, do you want to be made well? Do you want it? And he didn't even say yes at first. Sometimes when the Lord cuts to the quick, he's like, do you want this hope thing? Do you want it? Like, no one can carry me, Lord. He's like, get up. The guy stands up, is made well. So he healed a paralyzed person, a blind person, and his bodily resurrection. Here's the crazy connection. Jesus is called the son of David. David, what did he do to Jerusalem? When David attacked Jerusalem, it was known as Jebus. That's what Jerusalem was originally called. Everyone say Jebus. And Jebus was inhabited by the Jebusites. The Jebusites taunted David and they said, even the lame and the blind could stop you from conquering our city. And then Chronicles said, nevertheless, David conquered it. That's one of my favorite verses. It reminds me of the Nike slogan, just do it. It doesn't even tell us how. Like shimmy, I just shimmied up the shaft. We have no idea how. It's like, you will not conquer us. And then the next verse just says, nevertheless, he did. It's kind of a good way to approach your life. Like, you're not going to change the world. Nevertheless, I will. I love Jesus's mentality. You can't heal the blind guy. Nevertheless, I will. You can't be the light of the world. Nevertheless, I'm going to glow. You can't overcome depression. Nevertheless, I'm going to believe in the God of hope and abound in hope. It says just nevertheless, he did. But watch, David conquered the physical needs of the city, conquered Jebus, renamed it Jerusalem, and the lame and blind didn't stop him as they taunted. So their taunt was even the lame and the blind could stop you. But watch, the son of David then comes into the city. And what are the 2 miracles he does for other people out of the 3 in Jerusalem? He heals the lame and the blind as the son of David in the city of David, which was a nod back to the King David who conquered Jerusalem militarily, but Jesus healed Jerusalem spiritually. Amazing stuff. The lame and the blind can stop you, the early people of Jerusalem said to David. Nevertheless, he conquered it. And then the son of David comes in and the lame and the blind are the 2 miracles he does for other people in Jerusalem. If David could take care of Jerusalem's military needs, the Son of David can take care of Jerusalem's spiritual needs. And I want to encourage you on this Christmas season. I know you have obstacles. Those are opportunities. I know there are the accuser of the brethren words that are being assailed toward you. You can just say, let the weak say I'm strong, cognitive restructuring. You're going through fiery tribulations, you're like, good times. You're waiting on the Lord and you've sown in that area and for 5 years you're not growing in that area and then suddenly, boom, the fruit of the Spirit pops out of your life like crazy. You're going through life and you're a southpaw and everyone makes fun of you, but then you own your oddness and your oddity is your commodity and your dormant weakness actually gets so much attention that it becomes your greatest strength and his works are manifested in your weakness. And as you're passing by, suddenly you see miracles all around you like Moses with the burning bush or Jesus with the blind man at the pool of Siloam. Suddenly, as we go through life, not seeing the obstacle in the opportunity, but shifting it, and seeing the opportunity in every obstacle, there's no telling what God can do in our lives. And I want to encourage you that we are going to fight for hope. We are going to choose joy. We are going to believe in Jehovah Rapha. We are going to trust the God who heals. We are not going to sit down and lie in the dust. We are going to rise like a phoenix from the ashes because Jesus rose so we could rise. We're not going to sit down and get distressed. We're not going to look around and get stressed. We're not going to look inside and be introverted and get depressed. We are going to look up and get blessed because we are too blessed to be stressed. We are going to go through life absolutely confident that wrong will be worsted, that right will ultimately win the day and triumph. We know that we are baffled in order to fight better. We sleep because one day we are going to wake. We fall because we're confident that we're going to rise. We know that he who has begun a good work in us will be faithful to complete it until the day of Christ. So we will finish the work God has called us to do because we know he is both the author and finisher of our faith. So when I rest, he works and he makes clay. So I don't have to be a slave. He casts out all my shame. I don't have to wander in the wilderness. I enter into the promised land and the promised man because I don't just accept him into my heart. He accepts me into his heart in the temple veil. Is now torn. Everything is sacred. The whole world is a temple for the living God, not so that I can get into the presence, but so that the presence could get into me. And we are going to be an on fire generation. We're going to go change Applegate. We're going to go out into the Rogue Valley and people are going to see that we mean business. People are going to see happy warriors. And even when they say the lame and the blind could stop you, we're going to say, nevertheless, we're going to conquer because Paul the Apostle said, we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Literally in the Greek syntax, it's your super overcomers. He couldn't even think of language enough to describe just how much victory you have, because when we are weak, then he is strong. Cognitive restructuring, we're going to say we are strong, and we're not going to end with Jesus wept. We're going to end with rejoice always, because after death comes resurrection, after blindness comes healing. He causes the mute to speak, the deaf to hear, the dead to raise. Hashtag no big deal, low-key world domination. We're on a really good team. Come on.